All right. Hi, everybody. Can everyone hear me all right? I know it's kind of loud out there. All right, great. My name is Otto. Hi. First, I want to thank the Hyperwall staff and NASA and the organizers for giving me the opportunity to come and talk here. This is an honor, and I'm very happy to do this, so thank you so much. I'm going to talk a bit about methane in the atmosphere, and I'm going to talk specifically about a data set called UpCH4, and this is an estimate of methane emissions from freshwater wetlands, upscaled from Eddy Covariance fluxes, and I'll talk about what those are in a little bit. Methane is the second most influential greenhouse gas, and its concentration in the atmosphere is rising and even accelerating right now. NOAA keeps close track of this, and in 2021, methane increased by 15 parts per billion, and in 2022, it increased again by another 18 parts per billion, and those are both records for yearly increases. So, not great. We'll see how it is in 2023, but severe, serious methane mitigation now can delay global temperature increases for decades. So this is something that we really need to be thinking about right now. We can visualize methane in the atmosphere relatively well using satellite measurements like in this image from NASA's Scientific Visualization Studio. But it's difficult for us to attribute that methane to sinks and sources right now. Our top-down satellite estimates give good constraints, strong constraints on atmospheric methane, but our process models can't precisely say where that methane is coming from yet. There's isotopic evidence that it's coming from microbes, and that gives us four main possible sources. There's agriculture, waste treatment, there's wetlands, and there's open water emissions. Of those four, wetlands have the highest uncertainties. But there's more data that we can use to get at these sorts of uncertainties, because neither the satellite estimates or the process models use networks of surface flux measurements. And we have those. Such as Fluxnet. So Fluxnet and Fluxnet methane are networks of eddy covariance data. So Fluxnet methane compiles eddy covariance data from 81 different sites and I think over 200 site years into a single data set, mostly from wetlands. And I'm showing some photos from contributing sites here, photo credit to those involved in the sites. And on the right, I'm plotting the site locations that are contributing to this network, with different colors being different wetland types here. So they're clustered in North America and Europe. This is what we expect. The instruments are very expensive, and so this is prohibitive in a lot of areas of the world. The map itself is showing a monthly loop of a wetland area data set called WAD2M. So what you're seeing is seasonal variation in wetland area fraction, wetland cover over the world. So we can see some really strong seasonality, and to get at the methane emission dynamics that might come from this changing wetland area, the goal of my advisor Gavin McNichol and collaborators was to create an upscaled methane flux product for wetlands from eddy covariance fluxes, wetland data sets like this, and meteorological measurements. So I don't have time to talk about eddy covariance too much right now, but please come and talk to me if you have any questions afterwards. But very briefly, eddy covariance measurements lend well to upscaling like this because they're very high frequency measurements. They're taken over broad scales, and they come along with meteorological data taken at the same time. So I've plotted the product UpCH4 here from this effort. And this took data from 43 sites in Fluxnet methane and 119 site years, I believe, and brought that together to train and cross-validate a random forest model to weigh different predictors of methane flux from wetlands, mostly meteorological predictors, and the strongest predictor identified was temperature. So What we're seeing here is really the intersection of temperature and wetland area. This is a mean seasonal cycle that I'm displaying right now, but we have monthly maps from 2001 to 2018 using that WAD2M wetland data set. So we can see clearly the seasonality in the fluxes predicted coming from that wetland area. And on the in the top left here, I'm showing those fluxes divided into some broad latitudinal bins. At the top are global, that's the global totals. Next down are the tropics. Next down are the mid and high latitudes, and then the Arctic and boreal fluxes predicted. So first off, you can see relatively good agreement between our predictions, the UpCH4 predictions in blue, and the top-down and bottom-up products from the Global Carbon Project. And also, the majority of the fluxes are predicted to be coming from tropical areas, but you'll notice this is also where the largest uncertainties are. So, on the bottom right here, to show that a little clearer, I'm showing UpCH4 predictions from three sites outside of the tropics and one site in the tropics against measured EC fluxes from test sites that were not included in the model training. So this temperature dependence can reproduce relatively well the seasonal dynamics outside of the tropics, but then at this Peruvian site fails to really capture the dynamics. So something else is driving methane flux in the tropics, and it's likely dynamics of wetland inundation and soil moisture, which the meteorological predictors fed into this model did not capture in as much detail. So it's also important to note that we get different results with different wetland extent products, and a few of those are shown on the right here, the right middle. These broad latitudinal dins are a really common way to represent emissions products like this. But in order to really tease out these uncertainties to get at them, we wanted to look at finer scale variations, finer scale pattern in the seasonal and spatial variation of methane emissions and the climatic drivers that cause them. And so to do that, I mapped UpCH4, the methane emissions, onto a high-resolution data set of climate classes. So these are Köppen-Geiger climate classes, and they're shown over there on the left. And these are based on temperature, precipitation, and the seasonality of both of those. So in red are the tropics shown, the oranges are arid regions, and then green is temperate, blue is boreal, and purple is very, very cold. The climate map, or I guess the sites, first the sites here that I'm plotting, the circles are sites that are contributing to Fluxnet, methane. And the triangles are sites that are that have methane measurements right now, but they're not incorporated into our network yet. So you can see the sites that we're actually taking data from are very sparse geographically. But the climate map pulls out a few features very clearly. The boreal seasonality is really clear. In the wetland area that I'm plotting over on the top left here, you can see the boreal wetland area increases a lot in the summer, and that's accompanied by a pulse of predicted methane. I'm showing the seasonality of the methane predictions in the middle left there. And the tropics and other regions do not see as much seasonal variation in wetland area, but still display some interesting seasonality, and I'll come back to that. In terms of total fluxes, though, the highest fluxes are predicted from tropical zones and from the tropical savanna and monsoon climates, and from semi-arid zones. And this might be unintuitive. Why would there be wetland extent in semi-arid climates? These might be meaningful. I'll come back to them. These semi-arid fluxes might be meaningful. I'll come back to them in a little bit. But they could also be coming from an artifact in an albedo artifact in the wetland extent product, in that bright ground can look shiny, and so it can look like water, and it can look like wet land. Given the strong temperature dependency that we're using in this model and the uncertainty of the wetland area, let's exclude those arid sites just for now. And if we do that, then we're looking at much less of the total predicted flux. And now Aside from the tropical savanna, which predicts we have more flux predicted than the other climates, it's much more evenly split between tropical, boreal, and temperate zones here. So that data is actually also coming from very few sites, as I said. So we're looking for circles here. Those are the ones that are actually contributing. And in the tropics, we only really have two sites in Southeast Asia and one site in Latin America. So that's really not capturing the full variation. And these single sites could be measuring higher or lower than the rest of the climate. And also wind, water, and organisms can be transporting carbon horizontally through these ecosystems, which Eddy Covariance does not capture. So I wanted to end by showing you these two maps together. The methane emissions and the climate. So the climate map here is shown in color, and the methane is overlaid in black and white on top, sort of transparent. And I can look at this map for a long time, and I have. But a few big things kind of pop out here. A few big interesting things pop out to me. You can see again this really strong seasonality in the boreal areas, and you can see it's clustered in interesting spatial patterns here. But that's accompanied by some interesting, maybe even puzzling, spatial patterns seasonally predicted in the tropics. Say, for instance, in the tropical savanna or in the arid regions of Africa, and more these seasonal fluxes. A lot of these seem to be predicted at transitional zones between climates, such as in the edges of that tropical savanna in Latin America and Africa, or in the fringe of the Sahel here, or at the headwaters of the Nile. And so something interesting could be happening there. And by looking at how these fluxes vary over different climates across the world, we can get at this question of how good is our network. How well are we representing the variation in conditions driving methane emission that we would expect to see over the world? And maybe it can help foster some well-needed network growth in some of these very severely underrepresented regions like Latin America, Asia, and Africa. And more, like some recent upscaling work with CO2 uptake has shown, sort of highlighted the importance of seasonal conditions in semi-arid and transitional ecosystems. Work with upscaling methane flux like this could maybe lead to similar transformations in understanding of the global wetland methane emissions and potentially our understanding of the global methane budget. So thank you very much for listening, and I would be happy to take any questions that you have now. Thank you. And I'll leave that up because that's fun. Hi. The temporal resolution here is monthly, so this is a monthly loop. All right, this is a mean seasonal cycle calculated from 2001 to 2018. Yeah, and one distilled into one monthly cycle.